a visionary, a talent developer and self-believer. We could go on and on, but Berry Gordy Jr. was everything you could think of. To many, he was a godsend brought to save the people, the black people. In an era where it was common practice for white artists like Peggy Lee and Pat Boone to take songs from the black artists and make cover songs, Berry Gordy's mission to challenge the status quo by putting the black artists on the map looked and seemed impossible. But as someone who was always a risk-taker and calculative in his moves, did the impossible and it turned out to be legendary. He founded Motown Records, which came to be the most successful record company that America had ever seen.
And Motown went on to influence everyone. It was one of the most important things in the history of mankind.
From the Temptations to the Supremes to the Four Tops to the Miracles to even the Jackson's Five, he made it possible for the world to see the other side of the black people the world had never seen since the days of slavery. He gave hope to every upcoming poor kid that they too could be stars and appear on TV one day. All they had to do was put in the work and keep it burning inside them. Born on November 28, 1928 in Detroit, Michigan, Berry Gordy III was the seventh of the eight children of Berry Gordy II and Bertha Fuller, a middle-class couple. Their parents were very successful businessmen and owned a number of businesses ranging from a construction firm, grocery stores, a print shop and even a life insurance company. The parents were also known to be strict disciplinarians who encouraged their children to demonstrate a good work ethic and an entrepreneurial spirit. Berry Gordy looked up to his father and picked up some of his principles growing up. One trait that he perfected was the art of risk-taking. He dropped out of Northeastern High School during his junior year and decided to go all in boxing. Determined to prove all those who were against this, he trained like a beast, improving day by day. It is to no surprise that between 1948 and 1951, during his featherweight boxing career, out of 15 matches he fought, he won 12. He was later called to serve in the US Army during the Korean War between 1951 and 1953, a period where he also managed to serve as a chaplain's assistant, driving a Jeep and playing the organ at religious services. After his return from Korea in 1953, he married 19-year-old Thelma Louise Coleman in Toledo, Ohio. All along, his love for music never faded. He began writing songs and opened 3D Record Mart, which mostly sold jazz music. The business lasted just 2 years, and Gordy subsequently worked at Ford Motors' Lincoln Mercury plant. He continued to write music regularly, penning hit songs for Jackie Wilson and Etta James in 1957. Even after he decided to move his business from Detroit to Los Angeles in California in 1972, to expand his enterprise to films, his legacy will forever remain. He single-handedly shaped the soul and pop music industry. With all these, Gordy's awards cabinet keeps getting filled. He was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 1988. As a record producer and songwriter, he helped build Motown, launching the music careers of countless legendary artists. His unique sound helped shape our nation's story.
Gordy had teams of experts to produce hit songs and to teach young artists how to dress, dance, and act with politeness even in the most difficult situations. Most importantly, at Motown Record Corporation, a distinctive style was emerging. Great songwriting and melodies with a mixture of pop, black gospel, blues, and jazz combined with tambourines, hand clap, horns, rhythms, drums, and bass lines. This music became the soundtrack for the lives of millions of Americans, black and white. In 1962, shots were fired at a bus in Birmingham, Alabama, where Motown artists were performing. Gordy encouraged the singers to go on with their tour. He wanted his artists to show strength through these hard times, and to demonstrate they were there to stay, and stay they did. One success followed another. By 1965, the Supremes became the first female group to have 5 consecutive number one singles. They performed at the Copacabana, and they made the cover of Time. The amazing success of these 3 young black women was Motown's success as well. Clearly, color lines had been crossed.
Berry Gordy gave a new voice to black entertainers and artists. Motown influenced everyone. The music has endured and has become an integral part of American culture. In an era when black entertainers had no artistic freedom, the music of Motown would transcend race boundaries and stand the test of time.
and would never have had a presence in the pop music arena by thinking outside the record industry box. Berry Gordy virtually created a new genre, the Motown genre. The sound of young America not only brought unheard of opportunities for countless black artists, it also established a new norm for the music industry in general, and America as a whole. His accomplishment translated into a very progressive societal force. Berry Gordy, dreamer, songwriter, interpreter, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame inductee, Grammy Award winner, author, producer, and visionary, who in the face of persistent and now inconceivable hatred truly became the mastermind behind Motown.
In reading about you, the early days again, one keeps reading about Berry Gordy and that he discovered you and he groomed you and he made you a star.
Yes.
Did he make you a star?
I think Barry is very responsible for my career.
Could you have done it without him?
No.
Really? There would not have been this Diana, a Diana Ross? No?
Maybe a Diana Ross would have gotten started somewhere, but I don't think I would have gone to the, I wouldn't have done that, I wouldn't have started movies. Barry invested his savings into that first film, Lady Sings the Blues, because of me. I mean, I don't think anybody else in the business would have put that kind of money behind an unknown singer. I wanted to be an actress.
Berry Gordy is here. He is the founder of Motown. Need I say more? It had a profound influence on music, popular music. Think about the Jackson 5. Think about Michael Jackson. Think about Smokey Robinson. Think about Diana Ross and the Supremes. Think about the Temptations. And you think about the man who created it all. His name is Berry Gordy. He has now written his autobiography called To Be Loved, The Music, The Magic, The Memories of Motown. Welcome.
Great.
Diana Ross.
Diana Ross is, she's classy. Diana Ross is, she would, when the lights come on, Diana Ross comes on. I mean, I don't care what the rehearsals were. We would rehearse a number and she would just be fair, rehearsals, so forth and so on. Or doing a movie, Lady Sings the Blues. I mean, we rehearse and I would, you know, say, put it into rehearsal. And she would say, I'm doing it, I'm trying it. But boy, when those lights came on, Diana Ross came to life. I mean, she's a money actress. For the money, she can do it, whatever it is.
You loved her.
I loved her, yes, and still do.
But you do you still love her the way you did?
I mean,
she's the mother of your child.
That's right, yes. No.
And five wives, eight children?
I'm sorry?
Five wives,
no,
eight children?
No,
five
no.
women, eight children.
No,
eight children by five different
yeah,
women.
Yes.
Not wives.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Perhaps.
But was she the love of your life? Diana.
I would say so. And looking back, yes, yes, because she gave me more thrills than anyone.
What do you mean by thrills?
Well, thrills on the stage. I mean, you know, when a person can do her thing was, when if you can think it, I can do it, and anything
you,
I could think
if
of.
If you can think it, I can do it.
Yes, and when I wanted her to do Lady Sings the Blues, play the life of Billie Holiday, she had never acted before. She had never done anything, but it was a thought I had, and I felt that she could do it. And she believed it. If I thought it, she could do it. And she did, and she was nominated for Academy Award, and the movie was nominated for five.
Why didn't you two stay together?
Well, when she got married, I asked
myself. A lot
myself,
of this book is about relationships.
That's right. The book is about a lot of things.
Right.
You know, it's not just music, singing, and dancing,
right.
and
right.
so forth.
It's about
it's
life.
It's about relationship. About you're right. About life. It's
right.
about love. It's about winning and losing, and how to win, how to lose. Mm-hmm. You know, it's about values. But
Diana Ross, why didn't you stay together?
Well, Diana, I asked myself that same question when she got married. I said, well, wait a minute. The reason we did not stay together was because I knew what she wanted, and she wanted stardom in the worst way, and I wanted it for her. We had a goal. We had told each other that we would never let our relationship get involved with her career and my vision and my plan, and we were focused on that. But the relationship started getting in the way. It is very hard to, during the daytime, be this director and this person directing this talent and not letting them get away with anything. And every time I would maybe question her. She may think it's an attack or something, but really I'm trying to, you know, my standards were high. So it's one thing to direct a person and do a lot of things like that during the day, during the day, and then at night try to be a cuddly bear.
Hard to keep them separate, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, you know, and so...
So you come into the bedroom, and she say, "You're no cuddly bear," because I remember 5 hours ago.
Yeah. And even if she didn't say that, even though she appreciated it, see, Diana was very interesting, and even though we would fight over certain things that I might say in terms of directorial remarks toward her or that it wasn't good enough, whenever she did a show, it did not matter who or anybody, what anyone said. It was like, "What do you think, Black?" You know. And if everyone says, "You're great, you're terrific, you're fantastic," if she wasn't really fantastic, I would have to say, "Okay, you were very good, but right here you could do better," you know. And that wasn't always a good political thing to say, you know, to a top star that everyone says has
you're
done a wonderful job.
Everybody says you're the best, and you're saying you can be better.
Yeah.
Roll tape. Take a look at this.
When I met Berry Gordy, I didn't know that he was going to have this kind of impact on my life, but he was about, at that time, one of the brightest young Black men I had ever met. I mean, I saw him he was really someone who had a vision, who did not accept his life the way it was.
Man
but was,
who founded and built Motown Records.
Yes, and really had a vision. And
did
he's
you
also
fall in love with him early?
No, I didn't. No.
It took you a while, though, to tell your daughter that she was
his child. No, not really. It was just the way life, it didn't take that long.
Yeah. No. But he was a role model and a strong influence because he was bright, because he'd done something, mm-hmm. because...
Yes.
Yeah.
He's really a marketing genius, I think. Yeah. You know, I don't think today people really understand what he did from nothing. It's just like taking a lump of clay and making something into... People think Motown is this big, big company. And right. When we were making records, it's this tiny little building. You know, just a tiny building on West Grand Boulevard in Detroit, yeah. You know, where a big sound came from, the Motown sound.
I don't mean to be gossipy, but I'm interested in him and as well as you. Was he in love with you?
Yeah, I think so.
He was?
Mm-hmm. I think so.
And you couldn't...
No, I loved him very much, but not a passionate kind of love, not the kind of love that I've had with my husbands.
Yeah, okay.
I've loved him in a way you look up to someone that you admire, and I have loved him, yes, you know, and thought I was passionately in love with him, but I now as I'm older I look back and I say, no,
no,
it's
you
not
weren't.
The same, yeah. This is different.
Until you began a love affair with Berry Gordy, oh. And she said that's the reason that you were made the star, that you were pushed out in the front.
I'm not going to defend that. I think the audience knows that that's my voice on all those songs, and it had nothing to do with my relationship with Berry. I think he's a wonderful, he gave me an opportunity to shine. Berry believed in me. Berry sponsored me doing Lady Sings the Blues. He probably believed in me more than I believed in myself. And I, you know, I just think he's a very special man.
Well, I hear, and I have not seen it because I was flying back from New York last night, but an integral part of the story of the musical is the story and the love affair of you and Diana Ross. And I read that it was tough for you to kind of watch that play out on stage.
Yeah, did you have to mention that?
I'm sorry, I did. I had to ask it.
Well, you know, people would say, well, you know, if you're going to do your own story, you're not going to tell the truth. You're not going to do this. You're not going to do that. I said, no. I'm looking at this objectively, because whatever I have done in my life, there are other people like me all over the world.
Sure.
And so I'm not embarrassed by anything too much. But I have to admit, looking at that love scene every night, it's tough.
Yeah. It's tough.
Forever. object of your love. Your love.